Chester Norikis.
Here.
Roger Sprigg.
Absent.
Henry Quant.
Here.
And Wes Ryan.
Here.
Please stand for Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance.
Indivisible. Bill, much prefer the knife and free knife.
Where's Joe Dell now?
Nice to see folks join us this evening. First meeting after Labor Day, and still sunny and nice out there. Based on some of the statistics that have been passed to us in the last week, people seem to continue to view us on the internet, looking at the stats, so that is good. And again, Channel 4, the cable, if people are so desirous to see this City Council in live mode, and then if not, it's on a reoccurring what's it called?
Well, on the internet, it's on demand.
On demand,
they can get it whenever they want.
And it videos and right there. That's great. Let's do the public comments. Mr. Warner, it looks like you're the only one that has signed up. Good to have you back.
Mayor and Council, my name is Jerry Warner. I reside at 1233 Lakewood, Indian Shores. And I'm here tonight to discuss the new building that was just completed over on the property off of East Devils Lake Road. And the building, of course, is a 4,800 square foot building on the public works property off of East Devils Lake Road. Purported use of the building is for a sewer department. I'm going to quote you from the 2010-11 budget, Mr. Hawker stated. Not all our equipment fits in the shop, and some of it is parked outside in a very corrosive area due to the treatment plant more than the weather. The damage to the equipment is significant. We are in the stage of either adding a new small building at the wastewater plant or building a new building at a better location. In August 2011, a bid was accepted for $494,000 from a company in Astoria. Quade Construction, a local contractor here in town, bid was $710 higher. After the bid was accepted, there were 8 change orders at the additional cost of $52,746.61. That is an 11.4 raise in cost over the awarded bid. $38,000 was allowed for a problem with the dirt underneath the building, which is very difficult for me to understand. Normally when you bid building, you do your soil samples and determine that, but another $38,000 was okayed for preparation of the site. The total cost of the project was over $500,000. It was $515,746.61. The cost of that structure for storage was $107 a square foot. The building, however, also has thousands of dollars spent on the inside that was never reported to me when I requested it. The building use went for a vehicle storage area to include, also it was changed and you folks approved it, to include an office. This was not part of the original purpose. The building has 3 bays in it. If you take out the office space, the cost of each bay is $114,610. In talking with employees, the building will be used for a lot more than the sewer department operation. Over a month ago, I talked with the city attorney about the funding on the building. He said he would review it. I left him my phone number for a response. Absolutely no response in 5 weeks. Resolution 2005-3 was approved by the City Council for a $22 million bond sale after approval by the voters. The ballot stated that the bonds were for the improvement and expansion of the sewer treatment plant and collection system. This building is not built on sewer treatment plant site, but about 3 miles away. According to a menu dated July 5, 2011, Lila Bradley to David Hocker, the funding for the building was to come out of the sewer bond fund. There is no way you can justify that this building has anything to do with the improvement and expansion of the treatment plant. Because I've had no response from the city, on August 29, 13, I have filed a complaint with the Attorney General's office that this building's costs are illegal use of taxpayers' money and does not comply with the description of the approval of the bonds by the voters. These have also been sent to Representative David Gomberg, State Representative Roblin, States, and asking those people to follow up on this to see whether this is legal action whatsoever using that bond money. If there was any surplus bond money, it should have been spent on retiring the bonds and not spent on a building. I want to thank you for your time, and
great.
I have not had a response yet from the Attorney General's office.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Warner. Has anybody else wished to come forward, public comment, that didn't get an opportunity to speak? Seeing none, then let's move to the consent agenda. And the consent agenda, these items are considered routine and may be enacted in one motion without separate discussion. Any councillor may request that an item be removed for separate discussion and action. The consent agenda consists of, number one, minutes of the meeting August 26, 2013. Number two, construction change order, Canyon Sewer Pump Station. Number three, operations and maintenance manual approval, Canyon Sewer Pump Station Engineering. And number four, authorization to begin termination of right-of-way license agreement for property located at 1115 Northwest 2nd Street. And are there any requests for removal? All right.
I move that we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda as stated. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed with a nay? Hearing none. Thank you very much. We have a special order of business, the Visitor and Convention Bureau year-end report.
Good evening.
Evening.
Got a little PowerPoint here, so I'm going to get that set up, I hope. There it is, like. Most of this, by the way, is reflected in the annual report that's in writing, that's in your packet. Feel free to interrupt me along the way if you've got questions, or they'll get lost. The goals and challenges that the VCB faces are more than these, but these are the ones that most immediately came to mind. The two, of course, are the usual goals that the VCB has, and 3, 4, and 5 are the ones that were particularly difficult for us or new for us to respond to this year. Obviously, we've had a lot of changes in the grants, grant funds and the for-profit marketing partnership funds. We'll talk about that a little bit more later, and we've talked about it a bunch of times before. The near-term economic circumstances continue to change, and we have a little bit more difficulty in finding new and fresh things to use for promotion than we did before. The economy, as you know, continues to be a challenge. It doesn't seem to be quite as bad as it was before, but I continue to get conflicting information. For one thing, the transient lodging tax report suggests that we are up more than 7% year over year. I think it was close to 7.5%. That's gross lodging sales receipts. That's not the tax. I kept on hearing anecdotal stories from other lodging properties that were willing to share with me some of their situations, and I was hearing different stories. They were not feeling particularly up. There were some properties, frankly, that were in almost a crisis mode in as recently as the early and middle part of August, which is a pretty scary idea. So we have that question, that nagging question about, is the increase that we see in the gross sales a result of the average daily rate of lodging rooms increasing, or is it actually occupancy, or is it both? And I'll talk about that again a little bit more, and I did in a marketing partnership as well. We have also, remember this past year, a shift in the emphasis of the VCB away from events and more emphasis on electronic marketing. So really all we're doing anymore is kite festivals, the cook-offs associated with the Culinary Center and the Finders Keepers program. The rest of them we have either spun off or are very close to having spun off. We reconfigured staff a little bit. We increased the amount of time being spent on electronic marketing by 0.25 FTE this year and spun off all of those events that are listed there and maybe some ones I haven't even thought of. The remaining special events, one of the issues, if I broke down the costs again, events versus events that are run by other parts of the community or other parts even of our budget, you would still see an increase in the cost of events. And part of that has to do with general costs increasing, but also the kite festival costs have almost doubled because of the requirements that State Parks is now putting on us to get permits. There have been both positive and negative results of having changed the event configuration. For one thing, we do have a little bit more time to work on PR and other electronic media. On the other hand, general advertising really doesn't fly very well anymore. You kind of have to have something to advertise that's different from what you had before. And special events give us that, as well as anything that's added onto an attraction, like a new exhibit, for instance. When we shifted the events away from the VCB, they didn't all stay as heavily in the shoulder situation as we had hoped they would, and they also come together a little bit later than we would like them to come together, so we don't always have the information we need in time in order to do the kind of promotion we wish we could be able to do. So here's the event distribution that we have right now. About 39% of the amount of money is spent on community events, and that includes, by the way, the amount of money that we get from the for-profit marketing partnerships and the grant fund partnerships. Fireworks amounts to about 7%, and VCB events still amount to about 54%. Visitors, typical definition, we've seen it before, but for those of you who haven't been around it before, day trippers are considered to be those people who live less than 50 miles out. Overnighters are the ones we want because they are the ones who spend about three times as much as day trippers do, and they leave money behind rather than just using our infrastructure and taking our cash and leaving with it. So we like the day trippers, but we like the overnight market even more. So to get the overnight market here, we have to offer them at least 8 hours of things to do if they're coming from as close as the valley. The rough calculation is four times the amount of time it takes a visitor to get here is what you have to entertain them with. And we have to distinguish ourselves from our neighbors who are equally close and in some cases closer to, for instance, West Denver. The northern part of the coast is closer than we are. So we have to keep ourselves distinguished from the rest of them, or we're just as easy to and just as desirable to get to as the rest of them are. Methods for increasing the overnight market is to promote our natural surroundings, obviously. So we find the market that's interested in what we have, or what we do is we develop more product to fit the markets we would like to attract. And that's the part that's a little bit more difficult now than it was a few years ago. Here's a common observation. This one happened to be a little bit more articulate than a lot of them are, but it's one I thought was worth quoting. One of the challenges about visiting Lincoln City is that there really isn't a lot to do when the weather's bad. If we want to visit an attraction or we want to do something in addition to walking on the beach, besides the outlets, the shopping center never feels, or the shopping never feels accessible. We tend to drive down to Newport for the aquarium in Hatfield or up to Astoria for the museums and parks up there. And so what, for us, we are, for that person, convenient. But that same convenience is something that Seaside and Astoria and Cannon Beach can claim for those people in Vancouver or West Portland. I almost went back to Colorado there for a minute. We have developed a little bit more product this past year. We have a new wildlife brochure. We've enhanced the crabbing and clamming clinics, which actually started a little bit more than a year ago, and those have gone gangbusters. They are not only of real interest to our visitors, and some of the classes have as many as 80 people in them, but they are also a huge draw in terms of the publicity that they're getting. As recently as about 10 days ago, I did a 15-minute radio broadcast for a Northwest radio program that broadcasts in 50 stations in the Pacific Northwest. And we're also still working on the Heritage Trail, which we started a couple of years ago, but we're getting closer to the end. We have most of the panels done. They're up on the fourth floor. And as soon as I can get streets to stop working on streets and doing the job they're supposed to be doing, I'll be able to get them to get some of those up. Well, after they do another job for me that I've got ahead of them. Basic advertising options that we did this past year, they're higher in the budget you saw in June, but for this past year, the past fiscal year, we spent about $272,000 in advertising buys. And by that mean actually buying the space, not what it took to get them together to fill that space. We used websites of others for about 17 different websites. That doesn't include what I refer to as mirror ads. For a lot of print advertising that you do these days, in order to get your print advertising by, they offer you as an amenity an equal amount of advertising on their website. And so the 17 websites of others are just purely that. They are not those mirror ads. We did print, TV, radio, and in a number of different languages. We do that because most of the ethnicities in the world, although they may have joined us in reading and speaking English, still feel more at home and more appreciated and more welcome if we can greet them in their own languages. Our website is now completely mobile web ready. It has been in process for some time now. We had a couple years of hitch that didn't work quite the way we wanted it to, but we finally have it exactly the way we want it. It's easily used. You can get on it from your mobile device and see, and we have it accessible easily for people who have accessibility issues in terms of disabilities, not in terms of being able to get on their mobile. Social media is now up to two or three times a day rather than a couple of times a week. And we are still doing a lot of direct mail and fulfillment. I think the figures we put later on in this presentation. Advertising distribution, there it is, about 22% web, 32% television, 46% print. That's going to change over the next few years. And, in fact, for a while we were a little bit more web-heavy and a little less TV and print-heavy. And I've shifted back for a while for a little bit more television. And the reason I've done that is that although we are trying to court some of the younger generations now, the X's and the Y's and the Z's, and I think they're going to go into double A, I think, pretty soon. But for the time being, what we're finding out is the Y's are still at home, or at least they went back home because they can't make it out there in the world. They're living with their boomer parents. And so still the generation that has most of the disposable income is the boomers, and they're spending more time on TV than they are in a couple of the other places. So we've shifted back a little bit. I don't think that's going to last long. Finding the markets, we're looking first for niche markets rather than general advertising that's more like a shotgun blast. And as I said, we're looking for boomers primarily. X's and Y's are going back to the nest a little bit more as they're finding difficulty making it out there in the world. And the specific advertising mostly is in Portland and some of it in Seattle. Primary media changes we made this past year was that we filmed some more commercials, and we are now putting those together this fall and adding some more video that we'll be doing in September so that we have some more commercial readiness and so that we can alternate commercials when we're doing broadcast rather than boring people with the same commercial over and over again. Those oftentimes include translation, which we can't do in-house but have to do outside of the department. And we are courting the younger generations primarily through the universities. So we are going after, for instance, their print publications, the Emerald, some of their web advertising as well. And as I mentioned before, we now have a full mobile site. Web traffic. This is where Katara kicks in, and I kick out a little bit so she can explain to you some of the electronic stuff that makes me a little bit stupid.
Well. Thank you for that. So the last time I was here was about 6 months ago, and we talked about how some of our numbers look like they're decreasing a little bit. And I think we're looking at the fact that we didn't have a very mobile-ready site. We've already seen since we launched that site, July 1st, that the traffic has changed substantially. We're up past that, you know, June of 2013. Now we're up. But I think this is kind of based on we're looking at 30% of people are looking at our site from a mobile device, and it really wasn't as superb as it could be. Now it's looking much, much better. I hope you've taken the time to take a look at it. So that was down, but I'm thinking that a lot of that is moving back up because of that new mobile site. We've also done a lot of work with our SEO, and we did a redesign on the site a couple of years ago. It takes a couple of years for that to sort of get on Google's radar in the right way again. So pages per visit, we're looking at, we talked about this again 6 months ago. I think with our new design, people are getting the content that they want faster than they were getting it before. So, but also pages per visit are down, you know, for any number of reasons. But I think that's a lot to do with that mobile readiness.
One of the things I think that we're going to see happen more and more, and those of you who go on your mobile phones and search the web, probably will figure out that you target your searches much more specifically, and you just don't hang out there for a long time searching a lot of pages. So as mobile web searching increases, we're going to see page per views and the amount of time spent per page probably go down. So it's not an unexpected issue.
Same thing with the bounce rate, too. So it looks, on that last slide, it looks pretty high. I'm pretty certain that's just to do with the mobile. And it's already going down in the past couple months. So top content. So we've seen a decline. This doesn't show the year-over-year, but we've seen a decline in the lodging page popularity. I think that's to do with the overwhelming lodging apps on your phones, iPhones primarily. But you can book a hotel in a couple of clicks on one of those apps. So I think that's the reason why we're seeing a few less on that lodging page. But most of this, what we're enjoying, or what I'm enjoying anyways, is seeing that almost everything on this list has to do with the thing you can do when you get here. So people are really looking to fill their time. They want to check out our calendar. They want to find out our festivals, our events, the things they can do on the beach, the weather. So this is all very activity-based, and I think, you know, if we were looking at this page and it showed that people were going to lodging, dining, you know, other like infrastructure type pages, that I don't know. I just think this is really indicative of those coastal visitors come to get out and do stuff. So I think this is revealing in more than just the numbers, but the fact that almost every listing, with the exception of the lodging, has to do with getting out and doing something.
You might see there some asterisks behind a couple of the items listed. Neither of those items were in that top group of categories a year ago. And one of the things that we did when we changed the site was that we moved the Finders Keepers access button around a little bit, and all of a sudden it pops up now this year in the top 10 or so. So it really is an experiment in terms of trying to figure out how people find what they find and what they're interested in and why. And so you can actually simply move something on the web page or on the home page of the website and create a whole new interest that wasn't there.
So the top non-search referral sites, Lincoln City was on the top of this list last time as well. So that's really great. It means a lot of people are going through the site to find us, and so it's working well that we've got that button on the top of the page. The Chamber is in the ranks where the OregonCoast.mobi, so that's our previous mobile site, was basically just a placeholder. And so that's been eliminated. You won't see that next year. But that, 18,000 just from that, that's pretty big if you look at the overwhelming statistics about people looking at our site via the mobile splash page. It's pretty major. So, and we like to see that we've got a couple of local businesses on there. I mean, the Chamber, I guess, the Coho is the number one. Oh, wait, no, Horizon Rentals is number one, and then the Coho. So it's pretty cool that we've got those click-throughs coming from, small local businesses.
Should put that in perspective a little bit. The Coho has been on there 2 years in a row that I'm aware of. This is the first year that Horizon Rentals has showed up, but these are the only two lodging properties that show up in the top group.
So as we had, or as Sandy discussed earlier, we've been really, really hammering in on our Facebook campaign. I hope that you've checked that as well. It's very, very active. I think we've got it set up to even post during our our off times, so Saturday and Sunday when we're not in the office, we've got scheduled posts going through, and most of the time those posts are very, very intentional. So they may have something to do with an event that's happening that weekend. So we're really keeping an eye on that and trying to put content out that people want. So not just general pieces, but pieces about what we've found that people are calling our front desk and asking for. Facebook likes were up almost 2,000 from last time. Last time I was able to give you some numbers. I think we're right on track with the ones that I brought to your attention last time. I think we talked about Newport and Cannon Beach, and I think we've seen more increase than they have over the past 6 months since I've been here. So that's great. We're pretty happy with that. And our average reach has gone up quite a bit as well. So
explain to them what the reach is versus the likes, please.
Well, the reach, it's an algorithm, so I won't get into any detail, I promise, but the reach is basically it's more definite than a guess, but we're not too terribly sure. The reach is the number of eyes who've seen it because someone may have shared it or liked it, and their friends saw that they did that. So I don't know how active you are on Facebook, but if I repost something, my friends we got an impression from them because they viewed it, because I liked it, that would be included in our reach. So I can give you more on that later, but it's really long and drawn out. So this is just a graph kind of highlighting our climb on Facebook. Our monthly e-newsletter, we have gone up in sends and it looks like in opens. Looks like in last year, November, we have a little bit of a decline there, but generally moving up with that, we get entries from our website. We have a survey on the website, and that's one of the main places where we get new email addresses to add to that list. We also get them from physical surveys, and we're sending them out now. We've just actually did a redesign on it as well. We're sending them out now once a month, and we're getting more opens than we've gotten in the past. So you'll see the red mark is climbing, and I think that's because we are really, really focusing on giving content that people want, so they're asking for. Click-throughs, again, that speaks for itself. They're opening that and clicking through to, the content. We might post something about Finders Keepers. They're clicking through. They're not just opening it. They're, they're engaged with our content. Okay, so 3,700 website surveys. I don't know, Sandy, you do a lot more with the surveys than I do.
Yeah, we have a website survey going on all the time. We had a little bit different one going on this year because we're trying to find out some different information, essentially for an intercept survey, exit survey, hopefully conversion, but I don't know about that. But what the survey on our website, which was very much like the surveys that were done in other locations, we got 3,705 of those. Those were questions about market trends as well as individual questions. And we followed those up so that if the survey responder has a problem of some kind, I don't know when the Kite Festival is, or how often do you do the garage sale, we don't just ignore those. I read those every day, and it actually helps me to kind of stay up with what's going on with the market to be able to read those. So we follow up with those, and in some cases we respond to them right away and give them the information they need. And we also follow up with them by way of saying, yoo-hoo, if you're going to be here at a specific time, do you mind if after you've been here we email you again and ask you for additional information? And so we did that with 1,217 follow-up emails, and we got about a 15.4% response from people telling, which is how I got that quotation that I gave you a little bit earlier. And people seem to like that. We're marketing visitor by visitor, and instead of getting the answering machine or the number you dial to get to something else that you dial to get something else, you actually get a live person who just asked you how your vacation was and to tell you what was a problem and what was fun. And so we get responses like this all the time. Wow, I've never received so much attention from a visiting city before. And the value of that's just hard to quantify. It's never happened to me, and I'm over 60. Free editorial press, we're still pursuing that. Normally I give you a summary of free editorial press, and I didn't do it this time. And I didn't do it for a very specific reason. I think I told you a time or two before that we keep struggling with how to value this stuff. And it's gotten worse since we're doing all of this electronic media. I mean, Katera talks about reaches. Well, how do you assign a value to that logarithm reach thing that she was talking about? I have no idea how to do it. And everybody else is struggling with it, too. So a lot of us got together, and we've been sharing information and trying different things. And we're clear that old method of, you know, measuring the size of an ad and figuring out how much the equivalent cost of that would be if you bought it just doesn't fly anymore. So we've been looking for other ways to figure it out. And so we finally, last April, I went to a seminar at the Governor's Conference on Tourism, and Maxwell PR, which is one of the leading PR media companies in Portland, happened to be doing a seminar on just how to do that. And the conclusion they came to, which makes perfect sense, is that it's not the same for everybody, because what article matters for me doesn't make any sense for Coos Bay necessarily. It's sexy to say that we got in the Wall Street Journal. But how many people do you think read the Wall Street Journal article and came to Lincoln City? I bet you there isn't one. On the other hand, it's less sexy to say that we hit Oregon Coast magazine, but there's a much higher probability that has more worth for us. So what we're doing now as a staff is we're designing a new system based on the things that we know about our market, where it comes from, where we want it to come from, what things they're likely to be reading, how much or listening to, as the case may be, and trying based on that to assign some values to it given its characteristics. And from that, we're going to wind up with a number that this thing is worth. Now, that number doesn't mean anything to anybody in Coos Bay, but it does to us. And so by the end of the year, we will have some ways to compare ourselves to ourselves. And next year, we will have even more basis for being able to compare ourselves to ourselves and to know where we're getting the best press and where we're getting stuff that, although it's sexy, just isn't worth the trouble. So in the meantime, there's a couple of examples, and I put more in your packets. Market event measurement. There are lots of different ways to try to figure out what's going on with the market and how much impact a particular event might have. We do have the national, international reports. We have the specific Oregon reports. We have surveys. We have ad contests, all of those things, traffic counters that we've been talking about. We could pay for a whole lot of money to get some scientific study that may tell us the right thing or not. But One of the things that I wanted to bring to your attention, because I honestly don't know the answer to this, I just know what the problem is. And that is that I mentioned to you before that we have this gross sales number, transient room tax, that we get. Well, if you look at the most recent report, the June increase is over 10% just for that month of June. However, if you go to the STAR report, and the STAR report comes from a bunch of properties, lodging properties in Lincoln City, who voluntarily provide their information to an organization that produces this report to us. It's Dean Runyon. And I can get it for Lincoln City, and I can get it for Lincoln County, and I can get it for a bunch of other places that I can't reveal, but I can reveal those too. And so I thought, well, just out of curiosity, I'm going to compare June, which seemed pretty good and surprised me when I saw the transient room tax. And the reason it surprised me is I'd been watching the STAR reports. And if you look at the STAR reports, the first week in June, it said that our occupancy was up 6.4%. Every week after that in June, it was a minus number year over year. So what we were getting in gross sales is different by a plus minus than what we're getting when we get the STAR report. So what is that? Does that mean that the ADR is making up for the occupancy? Does that mean it's a combination of occupancy going down, ADR going up, or both of them going up a little but not enough? I mean, what is it? What's the issue here? We're measuring, for one thing, gross sales against occupancy. So that tells us that one or the other or both of them is an issue. Are we ever going to know? We're not ever going to know until we get it from the lodging properties. So until we have that number about what occupancy is really happening out here, we're not going to know why some of those lodging properties are having a terrible time and some others are not. And we're not going to be able to help them if they can be helped, because we're not going to know that's where their problem is or that's how we might solve it, because we don't know. Fulfillment, these are just the totals that we always look for every year. Fulfillment is that process of giving people what they want, basically. They call us or write to us or email us or do something saying we would like to have certain amounts of information, and we send it to them. We sent over 76,800 visitor guides out this year to various people who wanted them for various reasons. 66,000 of those come from leads that I get, some from Travel Oregon, some from the Oregon Coast Visitors Association, some from Sunset Magazine, some from Go Oregon, and a few other places. So those are people who have written into those organizations and said, we want information about the Oregon Coast. I get them, and off they go. We had 6,033 people walk into the visitor center and 3,657 call-ins. Most of those are done, the call-in stuff, most of that's done by the VCB. Most of the walk-in stuff is done at the cultural center. The glass studio, that's one of the two attractions that the VCB pays quite a bit of attention to. I don't have good numbers for you this year about what percentage of people came to the glass studio or came to Lincoln City just because of the glass studio like I used to, because again we were doing that different kind of survey, so I'm not just ignoring that, it's just not available. Otherwise the survey would have been about 10 pages long. Historically though, about 37% of people who come to Lincoln City who are take the survey at the visitor center or at the glass studio, I'm sorry, say that they came to Lincoln City because of the glass studio, and at least 80% of those say that they stay at least one night. The artists, contrary to what a lot of people believe, the artists pay the expenses there. They pay the utilities, which is about $5,000 a month. Their total expenses for utilities and glass and all of the other things that they need is about $12,000 to $18,000 a month. And they paid $950 a month to the VCB for rent. We put the sales room on hold. Remember, we allowed them to go to the showroom to start selling out of there. That year is just about up, and we'll take a look at that down the road. They are, remember, the only artists who ever responded to the RFP we sent out, and way back in 2003, two, something like that. The total expenses for the VCB this year was $3,133. Looks like $3 million. That should be $3,133.42. And that includes a cleaning cost of the showroom that no longer exists. We get from them, in addition to actually a profit, if you ignore that comma, we get a profit, and we also get, more importantly, that interactive experience for our visitors. The community benefit, we measured the first year or two, was about $6 million in overnight and about $2.5 million in day trippers. Again, I can't give that number to you this year. Culinary Center served 410 people in 17 private groups in 2012-13. All of those were visitors. And by private groups, I mean perhaps group tours, maybe just families celebrating grandma's birthday, maybe families who aren't getting along wanting to do a team building, something like that. 254 participated in hands-on activities and in the kitchen, hands-on stuff, and about 59% of them were visitors. And there were another 481 who did demo classes out in the demo stage, and about 60% of those were visitors. I mentioned the crabbing and clamming clinics before. We use the Culinary Center as well as the glass studio to some extent, as well as other things, for donations to other organizations outside of the area where we think that that donation is going to have an impact on promoting us as a desirable destination. You sometimes support the organizations that are supported by the people you care about, is the theory. And we donated about $2,600 worth of classes to the Culinary Center this year for that purpose. Not all of them get cashed in, by the way, but the nice thing about that is if you're going to use it, you got to come here. Mm-hmm. You can't just mail in and get a glass load or something of that nature. So it does give us some class that we wouldn't otherwise have without it. The revenue it's generated is right there. I don't have to read that off. Meetings and conferences, that's a group that we started about a year and a half ago. It's still happily in place, and the people involved in it are still active. We meet not as often as we did before, but about quarterly now. We're working on doing some co-op advertising together, not only with physical space, but also with some shared money. And while I was on vacation, they showed off in front of Travel Oregon and did this great presentation. Katera apparently was the lead on it, and convinced Travel Oregon to play with us a lot more than before, and we're hoping to get a lot more help with that in terms of being able to use their convention business for our benefit. The plan is to do some more of those over the course of the next year. And we still do the Extend Your Stay program, which is basically our attempt to try to reach the conferees of the meetings and conventions in Salem and in Portland to convince them to come here early or stay a little bit later on with their families. We get about 2 on the average a month referrals from our site for meetings and conventions, and we pass those along to the meeting facilities as is appropriate. And there's a little bit of a sample of what that group has managed to do. So it's got its own little advertising. It's got its own little pop-up for trade shows, along with a couple of others that we have for ourselves. We also provide some other services. The VCB provides other services to the community that I don't always talk about, but I might as well mention them once in a while. We do have mobility equipment that's available for visitors who do have disabilities, and that's being used more and more. We have a website that we believe is sight impaired, accessible rather, and if we find out that that's not the case, then we would like to know that so we can make appropriate adjustments. We try to support the bikers a little bit by having some repair kits available. The community calendar is still there, although it's not being used as much as I'd like it to be. The hot sheet, which is a weekly sheet that goes out to all the businesses, letting them know what's going on in town so that they can help us to promote the activities that are going on in town and help the visitors enjoy themselves more. Those are a real popular little item. We do a lot of special events permits every year. The grants and for-profit partnerships, you know about those. You've probably heard of, I know you've heard about them more than you want to in some cases, and will again tonight. We are starting now to develop an educational library for hospitality businesses. It'll be a series of essentially stationary webinars, if you will, films of activities and information that should help the hospitality business. I'm cooperating with the Oregon Coast Visitors Association in developing them, both with their resources and ours together for both libraries so that we can do twice as much as we could by ourselves. OCFA is an Oregon Coast Visitors Association is the organization that essentially got launched significantly by Travel Oregon when that 1% came in place. It existed before then, but it really didn't have a lot of oomph. It became a more significant regional partner in the last few years. I'm on the OCFA board. It's just continuous good information that we get by being associated with them and good partnerships with them. So it's an arrangement that we're hoping to continue for a long time. And we provide donations, as I mentioned before, to the community when necessary and when appropriate. There's the News Finders Keepers. If you haven't seen it, that's the new poster. It's out in town. If the rest of you who are here that don't have them want them, I don't have them with me, but bother us tomorrow at the VCB, and we'll get one to you. This is year 15, folks. So it's a big,
this is what?
Year 15 for this program. So it's a milestone, and I thought it was going to wear out a long time before this. It is not wearing out. It is not wearing out with the visitors. And I just got another call from a travel writer in Canada who wants to do an article on Finders Keepers. So there you go. Any questions?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
Actually, I have a couple of comments, if you don't mind.
No.
Let me move my microphone. I'm not sure who is doing it, but whether
if it's bad, she did it.
No, it's a good thing.
Oh,
I don't know whether
it.
It's the state, whether it's the county organization, or if it's because of the VCB or you know, it's the various motels that have websites. But this year we have had a lot of people from Germany, Switzerland, Belgium, and the Netherlands traveling through, and they are specifically targeting Lincoln City, which I find very interesting. That they, we had this about 2 years ago, and then nothing last year, and this year we've actually had a lot more coming through. That was one thing I just wanted to mention.
Travel Oregon.
Pardon? Oh, is it Travel
Oregon? Oregon's mostly responsible for that. They just are doing a superb job internationally.
Well, it really, really works. The other point was that you were talking about, you know, Portland and some of these other areas that you're advertising in. We're finding that we are getting a tremendous amount of interest out of Vancouver, B.C., Winnipeg, Spokane, and Boise, tremendous amount. Our travel from those spots is actually much higher than it has ever been before. So I think we may be missing the dime if we're not spending some sort of advertising, whether it's web presence or whatever, in some of those areas. And they're interested. These are people that come and spend traditionally 3 to 5 days, so they're looking for things to do. Some of them come here for the glass foundry and the aquarium. That's, you know, kind of like, yeah, and whale watching. And after that, and the shopping. And after that, they're at a quandary of what to do. And that, I mean, you know, you can. Some of these people are people who would go out and take a hike outside of just walking along the beach, but a good share of them are not people are people of age who do not want to hike on Cascade Head or wherever, or the weather may be kind of crappy, and they're all searching for things to do. We keep recommending that they take a day trip into the valley and buy some wine and come back and enjoy it as the sun sets. And some of them take us, you know, up on that idea. But there are, that's one of the areas that I feel that Lincoln City is really weak in, is we have no rainy weather things outside of shopping and the casino and the glass foundry really to do, or crappy weather. You know, I mean, sometimes the weather is really nice, but the wind is blowing 60 miles an hour from the north, and you're either getting sandblasted or frozen to death. So people really don't like to be out on the beach and things like that. And then my other final comment is, you were mentioning about the question of, you know, here is the transit room tax thing, mm-hmm. but here seems to be where things are. And last year we had a banner year. This year it's very flat, if not a little off. And I think part of that is why you're seeing that raise in the transient room taxes. I think some of the companies have had to raise their prices because products for and wages have gone up. And I think with some of the insurance things that are going to happen or are happening, I think some of the room rates are going to have to continue to go up. So you'll see a higher transient room tax, but not necessarily more rooms. And so, I mean, when you hear the anecdotal, we're not doing all that great, it's not just whining. I don't think mm-hmm. anybody is doing all that well. They're not starving, but I don't think that they're doing that well. Not certainly, they're off from last year. And I think everybody had a really good year, or most of the places had probably a pretty good year last year.
Let me go backwards and then forwards.
Yeah, I'm just kind yeah, of some no. things I wanted to mention.
Sure.
While we're going.
And I, frankly, agree with you in a bunch of respects. First of all, I think occupancy is a bigger problem than we think it is. I think that we have a tendency to ignore it sometimes because the gross sales looks better. And I don't think that that makes anybody feel any better. I don't think that means that things are particularly much better than they were before. They may be some, but I don't know. And I'm sure that people were having to raise their rates because of the things that you mentioned. We may be able to know something 5 years from now about what's happening now, but we don't know it now. As far as the not very many things to do here when it's the weather's not so very good, well, the weather isn't so very good for different reasons a lot. And I would be the last person to arm wrestle you over that issue. As far as the promotion is concerned, Winnipeg, no. I don't know that I've ever even given it that much thought, but I certainly will. We do in BC, we do in Spokane, we do in Boise. In fact, this coming winter, I'm going to be doing some OPB in Boise, which I've never done OPB before, but I'm going to do it now. So those, yes. I was going to go farther east in Canada earlier this year, and just before I signed the contract, all the flooding and so forth happened, and I didn't sign it for real good reasons. So yeah, Canada, we are exploring more and more, but I've never thought of that particularly.
We had an upsurge as soon as the first markings of spring. I don't know whether they had a really tough winter or what, but they had cabin fever, and they wanted to come far away from where they were, and they wanted to see the ocean. And they wanted to come to the aquarium. They wanted to go to the glass float. They wanted to look for floats. So they had been hitting websites. And that's how we got most of these, were through our own website asking us for rate or, you know, room availability, whatever. What is there to do? That's one of the biggest questions that we get. Is
link to our website.
What is there to do? Pardon?
Link to our website.
Oh, we are. We're linked to your website. You know.
So, Counselor, if I can,
yeah,
we can keep going.
I'm done.
But
Again, for the public, everybody, to remind them that you're speaking because of your experience
right.
in the lodging industry.
Right.
And again, just going for clarification, you've seen a lot of the benefits that have been spoken about firsthand. Correct? I mean, that's
yes.
That's where you're coming from.
I'm still working there, so,
yeah.
You know.
Right. Other comments, observations, questions? This side of Henry?
Thank you for the beach signs.
I was hoping you'd notice. I was going to be disappointed if you didn't.
I noticed it a couple weeks ago and mentioned it to somebody. We were trying to figure out who put them up, and they finally found out in the report that they put them behind. There's, as a matter of fact, the other day I was out 21st waiting to come out on Highway 101, and these people were driving by in the car, and you know how you watch the face of the people in the car, and this lady sitting up there, she's pointing up in the sky, and the only thing she could be pointing at is the beach sign. So I noticed they are being noticed, too, so I appreciate that. I did notice them. I don't know how many other counselors have, but they are through the city, and they look really good.
I do listen to you.
I know you do. I know you do, Sandy.
We're going to talk about his name-dropping in your written report. It seemed like you were giving him way too much credit, Sandy. That's in the written report. So
I'll try to tone it down next time.
That's all right. Other counselor?
Sandy, I got a email calendar, casino calendar, and I was pleased to notice that there were more than just casino events there, that we seem to be organizing and partnering with a number of organizations to have a more inclusive calendar, and I appreciate that.
Casino and the VCB, keep them both as thorough as they can be, so no matter which way you're coming from, you hopefully will run into all of it.
Other comments? Thoughts? Cindy, I may be repeating myself from 6 months ago, but I thoroughly appreciate the report, this year-end report, and I think the last one was a six-month report. What I like about it, and I'm hoping the public at large actually goes and reads it as well, because it's so informative about all the things that's going on. And I know a lot of that stuff you're putting in there as a refresher for yourself and the reader, and it sometimes gets or feels repetitive if you look at the reports versus the marketing plan and that kind of stuff. But I would suggest the reader keep going after it, and it's very informative, and I think more people ought to look at it. I guess for me, an observation, when I read the report versus tonight's PowerPoint. Love the PowerPoint, short, concise. The report goes on and on and on, but good background. I guess I'm wondering, though I didn't hear it tonight, when I read the report, I walked away with a feeling, and I just is just me, a feeling that you were setting the stage, or at least opening the door to increased staffing, to requesting the VCB to get back into handling events, and requesting, to Councilor Ryan's point, some kind of indoor facility. I heard and felt those three themes, and like there was no request. It was more what I say a setup or drawing our attention to what might be coming. Am I on?
No, with respect to the first one, that's not in my head right now. And if it ever is, Mr. Hawker will know before you do. The other two, I don't know that I've ever stopped beating the attraction drum.
Right, you haven't.
And as far as the event drum is concerned, it's true that it really has made it more difficult for us to find news, because that's really what advertising is these days, is news. And missing both the attractions and having more difficulty with the events, we're less flexible. There was, during how the VCB got into all of those events was that when the recession hit, we didn't have any more than we have now.
Right.
But what we thought of was, oh, my God, what can we do as quickly as we can to try to solve a weekend for next month? And that's what we could do. We had the staff and the experience to slam it together and make something a little bit better than it would have been without it. And we did that for several years, and we actually built up some pretty decent events over time with those. We don't have that flexibility anymore, or we don't have much of it. So if we have somebody who's taken over even one of our old events, and we have no idea what the details of it are going to be until the week before it's going to happen, we can't do much with it. And so actually, as far as that's concerned, I really don't want to get back into the business of doing events. But it's really more of an appeal, I guess, to those folks out there who are doing events. And we're going to start building some things into the grant contracts to make that a little bit tighter business for you to get your money. You're going to have to talk a little bit sooner and plan a little bit farther in advance. But that only works for the ones we're going to give grants to. So for the rest of the folks who are planning events out there, please understand that a month, you tell us a month before it's going to happen, we can hardly do anything right. with that.
To assist in the marketing and positioning. Correct.
Yeah.
And I guess I also heard, and you spoke of it here, the bit about trying to fit a component in, if you see an opportunity to create a new event. So I'm wondering, and I'm just making an assumption that you do it, when you and your staff have, you know, brainstorming ideas, that you keep track of those and share them with the nonprofit world or profit world at large, as here's some things we've thought about might be a good event opportunity. Because I'm like you, we're new into this fund thing, and we've, as we expected, making some adjustments and adjust going on, but it seems to be the same events. Somebody's just picked them up from the VCB, which is great, but we haven't seen, and I guess I haven't seen a list, but I'm going from a sense of what I read that it's the same ones.
Yeah, you'll get a list in November when the VCC brings its report in, but I'm pretty certain of the statement I'm about to make, and that is that with all of the funds that have been put out there over the last couple of years and the two funds that you created, I believe that there are only two that are the result of those, that is, two that didn't already exist, and everybody else is coming to the bank because there's money in it. And that isn't necessarily a bad thing, because that, for, you know, that can allow you to expand it and all kinds of stuff, but I'm not seeing the event explosion I was hoping to see, which makes me beat the attraction drum even harder.
And if I can now, you lead me into that. I'm remembering the TRT comparison chart, famous for Mr. Hawker, when he compared TRT to that community in Lincoln County that had and marshaled attractions. And its line was slowly increasing while Lincoln City's was spiking. And at that time, and continued to be, events were driving that. So are you changing your tune now, or is the, you know,
I didn't know my tune.
Well, what I heard you say is now you're beating the drum for attractions.
I'm beating the drum even harder for attractions because we don't have the events. That I was hoping that we would have. I assume that if the VCB had stayed the way it was, we would have been continuing to try to grow more events, and, you know, it would have gotten, the snowball just would have kept on getting bigger. But I'm not suggesting that this was a mistake to do this at all. I'm just saying it hadn't turned out yet the way I wish it had turned out, and absent that, and absent any new events or any new attractions growing up in this town, I'm, very frankly, Mayor, it scares me. Okay. We're already behind. It scares me so much that 10 years from now we are going to be so far behind everybody else. That's what I was saying about, yeah, we think we're convenient, and we are, but we're convenient for Salem. Astoria, Seaside, Cannon Beach, they're the ones that are convenient for Vancouver and West Portland and Seattle. So we're having to work real hard even to get those folks. It just scares me.
But That's what I know you love doing, is working hard. Nothing stays the same, so.
Yeah, work hard, be scared. Works for me.
We'll get to the funds and stuff later. But I guess I'm looking for, as I was going down the report, and in events, because as you recall the conversation, we're concerned about, you know, accountability or what events cost us in exchange. And I found it interesting, as you were listing the events, like the Kite Festival, you threw in an expense item. The minute you got to the cook-offs, there was, you know, it was absent. Now, when we moved to, I'm assuming, the VCC report in November, I'm assuming we'll see information on those events, because what the grant was anyway, what it cost.
Like, yeah, I could certainly do that. I just stopped, no, frankly.
Yeah. But I'm reminding you, as you think about events again, you know, it's still, I need to know what it costs. That and
understood.
The other, which I didn't see in the report, and was stuff about other, and I don't know what to call them, sponsorships, partnerships. I'm thinking of Disney Radio. I remember a convention with the casino. You sponsored with them different things, and you came to us for, and maybe it's too early, where we authorized the $500 kind of stuff, move it and move on kind of routine. Other activities that I know you're involved in where you have your pot and can participate, are there not many of those? Are there, and does that pay dividends back?
There are not very many of those of significant size. In fact, other than those two, I'm not thinking of anything right off the top of my head. The little ones that we talked about, where, you know, we just make donations and so forth, that list I think I put in the report for you, because I know you wanted that list. So that's there, of when we, you know, partnership in that way. But I'm not thinking about other ones right now.
And again, you had the convention and conference, and I'm glad to see it because I was curious if that was still going. In your report, you talked about 5- and 6-figure crowds and the inability of someplace to handle that kind of crowd. And I'm wondering, where on the coast who handles that crowd?
Seaside.
Okay.
There's one. It's difficult. 5 figures, fine. 6 figures gets more and more difficult because of the need to change out rooms, banquet rooms, and all that kind of stuff. So we don't have very much for that. Chinook Winds can do some of it, but there are lots of conventions that would be considered medium-sized in the world that Chinook Winds is too small to handle. Okay. But Seaside's got its own convention center, and other than that, on the coast, I don't know of anybody. The coast is not a big meeting and convention kind of place. There's some of it that can happen, but because the transportation issues are so hard to get here, small meetings, government meetings from the valley, that kind of thing works, but I'm not going to get a big AMA convention, even if I could fit it in Chinook Winds. I'm not going to get it here because nobody wants to go through what it takes to get from Portland to here. Why not stop in Portland?
Agreed. Yeah. So I guess what I heard you saying, and the business of bringing people and marketing Lincoln City remains challenging, and I don't hear you resting on our laurels. You're on it. The change to social media, the type how we advertise. So I compliment the move and trying to get the public to see the move that the industry has had to move to. And it remains to be challenging.
If I thought we had laurels, I'd rest.
Okay.
But yeah, it remains challenging.
So, okay. Any other thoughts, comments, observations? So the next item you had, the marketing plan,
yes.
And you had attached that to this report as well, and the redlined, the red line was some updates that you added to it because it was a two-year plan.
Yeah.
It's kind of placeholder.
I didn't think I was going to do it at all because it's really just minor stuff. But as I told the VCC tonight, I always worry about leaving something out of the memory of the corporation,
right. Yeah.
In case something happens to the corporation. So I added some stuff in there, a reminder that the Chinese are coming, and we do need to make some adjustments for the Chinese. But other than that, frankly, there's nothing substantive. In fact, there isn't any change of behavior that's significant enough to look at.
Didn't either. So,
but I didn't want to make a mistake and leave it out.
I appreciated it. I did notice as I clicked on and all the attachments and then went to the second item, and it only took me half the marketing report to read again to figure out I'd already read it, you know, in the other attachment.
It helps. It sticks better sometimes if you read it a couple times.
Thank you. Then our third item was you've continued with the funds.
I remember we sent a whole bunch of stuff back to the VCC, and they went through it all, and I redid the agreements and the contracts. True to form, I made a mistake, and on the nonprofit guidelines, I forgot to change the payment schedule on the first page from 50-50 to 33-33-34. That is, by the way, our effort to try to get people to give us marketing plans before they get their money. But this is the resolution of all of those things that they wanted, changes they wanted to make, including the date changes, and we're just asking you to let us find out how these don't work very well.
Well, I noticed that too. If you would, I don't know how you go to it, but I found numerous. The 60-day, 45-day is also.
I'm perfectly capable of doing that. Do you want to stick that in my box and I'll fix that? Or do you want to do it some other way? Or you could put that in my box?
But I also found it on the for-profit as well.
Okay.
So both the. Then the other thing that I went down looking at the list that originally came to us, you know, that we brought back. So I was kind of checking off. And what I found on the reports was, and I applaud the changing the local better definition that in the nonprofit category, it doesn't have to be a local Lincoln City nonprofit, that if it benefits Lincoln City, great. So I like that, Ed. But
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Was that for-profit also?
The for-profit doesn't matter. It's just doesn't have to be from Lincoln City. Is that what your question?
Yeah. The impression was it should be for both. If I didn't say it, I will. But the feeling is if somebody's willing to come here and do an event that benefits
right.
Lincoln City, who cares if they come from Canada?
Yeah. Is that how you read it?
Yes.
And is that all right?
I have some feelings about that, although I don't know this is a time or place to bring them up. I just want to make sure I understand it.
Okay.
And I do. I mean, if it were a perfect world for me, I would rather see the event coming from a sponsor here in Lincoln City. But I realize that it might not be possible all the time. And then I hearken back to what you're saying, or have said to me, or have said to us in the past of not micromanaging relative to, we do have a visitor convention committee that takes these items along with Sandy and looks at them. And so I have to rely on, or I want to rely on their recommendations.
Yeah, but I would be careful. I think, as Sandy has indicated, I'm hearing her say that there's a limited pool of nonprofits and folks who are going to do events. So by reaching out further or allowing the door to open further makes good sense. And to me, that applies to the for-profit as well. if it benefits Lincoln City, and again, back to the VCC committee who makes these evaluations, if they see appropriate value back to Lincoln City, that why shouldn't we participate with someone who's bringing value to the city?
And I understand that. I just
okay. Have
to say that relative yep. To my, you know, it's just a feeling that
yep. I
have. And maybe in the future, if it comes to having more applicants than there is money, and the value is here in yep. Lincoln City.
There you go. Yep. Yeah, so far that hasn't been a...
No, but,
you
know,
now
that there's finally money to these things, I don't know why some people would not want to, you know, stick their toe in the water.
My sense is, Counselor, that this group of people would give preference to locals before they would give preference to out of the area if it was a straight-up competition for dollars.
Okay, thank you.
I think, if I can, not to Hoover it, but the other is, remember, for the for-profit side, it's just marketing dollars.
Right.
So that means you have to have some money into the game, into the event, you know, that you want to market. So.
And that's a good point.
That could eliminate.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that up.
But, Sandy, I was going down the list, and I guess I didn't see, there was the questions on the back in June, number 4 and 5, that talked about the number of times an event can be awarded. Should there be an absolute limitation on the number of times an attraction can be awarded?
Thank you for reminding me of that.
And I didn't see that in the write-up.
Yeah, that's because I left it out of there, and I forgot to tell you about it tonight on top of it all. There must be some kind of mental block here.
Yeah.
Actually, the VCC is of the firm commitment that absent emergency or some unforeseen event, that special events should be limited to 3 years to get off the ground, and attractions dealt with on a case-by-case basis, on an annual basis, and not with any particular restriction. Their rationale for that was, and I talked to them about this tonight, their rationale for it was that attractions may need help forever, but we would like to see them move forward, and there may be some ways we can encourage them to move forward. Special events, however, if they are not floating after about 3 years, need to find help elsewhere or need to rethink what they're doing. So they 3 years for events, absent an emergency, no firm cutoff date for attractions.
Just a question I have is, if an event, you know, and I'm remembering the application sheet, we make them, the nonprofit, give us expectation of the event, added value of the event. If for $5,000, pick a number, grant request, they're booking rooms well beyond their expectation and the VCC's expectation, but it's now year four. Why would we change an event? Why would we not, if there seems to be a public outcry and participation? Pick on Antique Week, pick on, you know, Iris, pick on Siletz Bay, pick on, you know, anywhere people are coming to town. And, you know, it's a relationship of how much money they're asking for versus what's contributing back into Lincoln City.
I can take that back to them, but that was their conclusion, and for those reasons.
Huh. Pretty hardcore.
They've dealt with so many of these things this year. They've gotten hardcore, I guess.
Okay. So I guess that then leads me, because I now that you've said that, how are we handling it in mid-year or this period, this year? Because we haven't given them any notice, right?
Yeah, we're not letting any decisions that we're making now jeopardize anybody who didn't know about them until the last minute. So that's including, for instance, the January and July deadlines. Anybody who doesn't fit within the definition that's coming with this round is going to be listened to and their application is going to be dealt with as if it's still okay under the old.
So since we missed the July 1, so the January 1 deadline applicants?
Well, if you have something, for instance, if you have an issue, we had one tonight come up where the issue is in December. So we didn't say, sorry, you're out of luck because we just decided to change the dates. We took that on because it would get jeopardized by it. We did two others, too, so there were like three altogether. So we'll continue until we weed out the ones that we will have prejudiced or would have prejudiced by making these changes.
Okay. And then we did do the dates attraction. I did see in there, too, a block out June end, 1st of June to the end of July. Is that the blocked-out dates?
They blocked out July and August, primarily, because they were straying. We were straying into July and August activities. The feeling was that we need to go back to where we were, which is to put our energy, our money, our emphasis primarily on the shoulder and off-seasons to help with the economy.
Even though what you said a little bit earlier.
Yeah. Okay. I don't make all the decisions.
No, I don't. I'm not shooting the messenger. I'm trying to understand the rationale of the committee.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know any more than Councilor Ryan does whether things are better or worse. I don't. So okay. I couldn't answer that one.
Okay. And, you know, did anybody else have questions regarding these funds or? I sure don't. Lockout periods, application dates. And one, it was just wording. I noticed that you put in, again, to your point, trying to get earlier notice, wording that said recommend anybody requesting over $1,000, recommend come see you. And yet it goes further to say application will be rejected if you don't. Why use the word recommended?
The recommendation was for. The rejection was for the ones that are where there's a $5,000 requirement. So I'll look at that language again and be sure that's clear. But yeah, we want them at the $5,000 level so that we can be certain that the money's being managed well for every $1,000. We don't necessarily want that.
I just again tell them right up front that you need our help, so come in here. Yeah.
Wish that worked.
Other, Woody, you're all right?
Yeah. Okay. I have no question.
I guess I'm hesitant. I know you're asking for approval of this.
Of what?
Of the these changes. Is that how I'm reading?
You wanted me to bring them back to you, except for the deadline, or except for the money issue, which was already resolved. Do you want me to bring them back again? I can.
Well, what I'd really like to do is hear the committee, not necessarily here, but you know, I'm for the councils. I'm caught up with the 3-year drop dead issue, regardless of circumstances.
I'm not.
Okay.
And I'm not because I've run events before. If you can't. Special event, at least break even in 3 years, it's a bad event. You need to get rid of it.
Let me help you. I'm glad you said that, Mr. Ryan. If I can, what you just encouraged me to do is not to break even as an event, because I'm smart enough to figure out that the minute I turn in the black, you're going to dump me.
No.
Instead, I would ask you, as I said before, to look at the benefit of the event to the city. And let's say I make $1,000, $10,000. I'm building, you know, a business here, even though I'm a nonprofit, making events, paying and filling up rooms for you, and you know it costs money to do these things.
If you're filling up rooms for me, then you're making a profit. If you're not making a profit or at least breaking even, you don't have a good event. That's the way it works.
I don't know that I agree with that.
But I've certainly read it. I don't read it that it's an open end anyway. It's 3 years. You have 3 years to prove yourself, period. Make it or break it. You know, and I think that's actually a very long time. I've spent 40 years in broadcasting where we did events. And absolutely the third year, if it didn't go over, if we didn't generate a profit, it was gone. It was totally revamped. It may be the same kind of event, but it was totally revamped. Same way in the motel. You know, if we have an event that we try, if we don't make something out of it within 3 years, we're not going to do it anymore because it's not worth the effort and the expense. That's just good marketing sense.
Okay. Other thoughts, counsel? Because the action is, recommendation and request is to move forward on this from the BCC's recommendations as you've seen it and added. I think the only thing is the 3 year.
Yeah.
I thought I had it all clear in my mind. Now it's kind of gone fuzzy again. But I tend to agree with you because I say if it's bringing people into town and things like this, putting heads in beds, then I don't see why it wouldn't continue. If it was breaking even, or maybe it's not.
I don't know, Councillor.
I want that person to come in and buy that. Buy the bedroom, buy the meal, and things like this. They're coming to town for that purpose. And
well, I guess to me, it's not that not simple as that. I guess I'm most concerned that it's a 3 year in and out, and I'm looking for the ability of the BCC to make a judgment based on the event and its history, because I guess, and I'm thinking of the data they have based on the request for the money. 3 years, they've got a report that says what they delivered. Assuming it was good enough year one, you gave them year two, gave them year three, so that tells me probably there's some projections increasing. And now you have a nice package of where's this going? And, I'm thinking out loud, and I'm, pick on somebody. Siletz Bay, they got $5,000 1 year, $7,500 the second year, a two-week music thing, a lot of out of town, and I'm just wondering, I forgot what their total budget is, but the $7,500 is so minute in the overall expenses that it's almost a sponsorship or buying a little advertising, and why we wouldn't want to be attached to a quality event. But to have, the way I read this, to have the council, the committee just say 3 years and we're done, unless, Sandy, you have the ability, after we wash them off this fund, to still make decisions of a sponsorship, some kind of, it's a quality event, we want our logo on their stuff,
I'm nervous about calling the same thing something else. I tend to agree with the fact that it's a judgment call, that we really have to balance the benefit against the cost, and whether it was the Cascade Head Music Festival or whether it's Siletz Bay Music Festival, those type of things help with branding. And they're never going to be self-sustaining. So my suggestion, if council has trouble with the 3 years, adopt it without that in it.
Wordy.
Sandy's going to argue with us.
One is, what do you do when, pick on Siletz Bay Music Festival, is in the black, makes a profit with the VCC money? Then what?
With the VCB money. Well, I would hope they would make it into the black.
Right.
Two, we're not giving them so much that you know, $7,500 in this case. You know, I mean, last year, am I correct? That was what we gave them.
I don't remember.
Yeah, I so it
probably $5,000, but I don't remember. Yeah.
And I'm so what? They make $5,000. You know, is that what you say, or you know, ten? And when I look at their expenses, you know, what's the overall cost of that thing? $100,000? Big bucks.
Well, I guess what I'm doing is raising here a lot of little increments of where things can shift and everybody can have a different opinion. That's one thing. The other thing is that we asked them to make this decision, and they did.
Agreed. I guess, you know, part of me says I'd love to hear them. You're delivering without, you know, the counter-arguments or, you know, examples back. The other is I'm looking for maybe wording that has flexibility, you know, that something that says we don't, as a general rule, we stop funding after 3 years. Exceptions are made for something. I just hate to be shooting ourselves in the foot of not being part of a successful operation.
What you're talking about, Mr. Mayor, is a sponsorship. And if that's what you're talking about, that's different than helping to fund an event, a one-time event.
That's what I was just asking, too. Do we have other means?
Yeah,
and I didn't hear a positive.
Well,
we
have other means, but then we're looking at trying to value, what is the value of the VCB's logo, the city's logo, the VCB city's logo, on a piece of collateral that's handed out at a concert or in an advertisement someplace? I mean, really, then you're starting to get into those things. All right, we're going to give them $5,000. Is our logo in this place worth $5,000, only worth $2,500? I guess we're really asking for a lot of grays to be answered by a committee with a lot of black and white.
And except, though, this committee is made up of all the people that do it for a living.
Do you want me to have them come back and meet with you, or do you guys want to meet with them?
Well, I'd like to meet with them. I don't know we need to take public time, council time. Why don't we put it on hold? Let me meet with them before the next council meeting.
Okay.
If that's all right.
And
I'll come back to council, and we'll have it on.
Okay.
Does that foul up anything you're...
No, I'll just try to arrange something. Can't be one of their meetings because of the obvious issue, but I'll try to arrange a meeting that doesn't conflict with your stuff.
That'd be good. Yep.
Okay.
Is that all right? Council Chester, please.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I'd like to go back to your memorandum, Sandy, to David on page 1, paragraph 4. The additions have been considered and approved by the Visitor and Convention Bureau. Did you mean to say Visitor and Convention Committee?
Probably, if we're talking about the additions for the...
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Yep.
Any other questions, comments? Yep.
You know, Mr. Mayor, I think if you meet with Sandy and a representative of the VCC, just kind of I understand what you want to do.
Okay. Well, I want to make sure it's all right with council, and then we'll bring it back.
I mean,
it'll bring back a,
eventually we'll get back to council.
Yes, right.
But I see what their thinking is. You know, and it could be semantics, but still, words mean something.
Right.
So they have to establish some guidelines, and that's what they're trying to do.
Yep. No, I appreciate what they're doing. I'm just absent their thinking, you know, because I think it's impactful. So,
okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. From events and marketing to city manager report.
First of all, I apologize for the header on the agenda. It said sewering the lake, and that part was right. And then it put parentheses Northeast Lake Drive. I'm not sure how that got there or what it has to do with this. But
right.
So anyway, this is about sewering the lake, all around the lake, the whole lake. So I had given you a real rough estimate of $5 million to do a backbone pressure system around the lake. We got a preliminary design. I don't mean a construction design, but I mean a map showing every line, where every line needs to go, from one of the companies that provides that service and provides the pumps, and a linear feet of each size of pipe, and they added a lift station, a booster station in the system that we didn't realize would be needed. And we then, knowing our local costs better than they would have, put prices on each size of pipe, the amount of footage that they had shown, and some estimates on asphalt restoration, gravel restoration, et cetera, which are pretty sizable numbers, and came up with and added 15% for engineering and 15% contingency, came up with $4,667,000, close enough, $5 million. Hit it lucky that time. So it, to me, is a if we can find a way to finance it and deal with the maze of regulations and legalities and opposition and so on, it sure looks like it's an achievable system. That I think the most pressing question is how would it be financed? And we're looking at roughly $350,000 a year bond payment to do this all at once. And I didn't deal with in the memo with doing this in phases, which could be done. This was to build the system all the way around. I would really prefer to see a district. It's doubtful, the more information I get, it's doubtful that the Devil's Lake Water, Devil's Lake Water Improvement District could do this. It's not within their scope. So that means if a district were going to handle this, it would have to be a new district, which, of course, that and the financing would require an election by the people affected. That's one way to do it. That's preferable because, number one, is we think that they would have a great opportunity for grants, perhaps up to 50% of the cost. City probably is not going to get such a grant. We can explore that a little bit more, but so far we've been frozen out of any kind of grant like this. And when you look at the grants that are funding things like this, they don't go to cities our size. They just plain don't. So another way to do it would be a surcharge on those around the lake and those near the lake, and a increase in our sewer or water rate across the board for all customers. It'd be a difficult pill to swallow, I think, without a grant. It comes out to be something like, put the numbers in here somewhere. $40 surcharge per month on all customers bordering or very near the lake, and half of that on all other customers tributary to the lake. That would be $20, and 4% on all other customers in and out of the city. So that would presumably get it done. That's a 20-year bond issue, So that charge would be in effect for 20 years. Of course, over time, that would seem less and less. The 4% would be an initial 4%, not 4% of the sewer rate in 10 years from now. So there it is. If we want to proceed on this, I've listed some steps that we ought to take. They're not inclusive. One is to get some feedback from Devil's Lake Water Improvement District, because anything we do on this, I think we need to have not only that their vigorous support, but their participation. We need to visit with DEQ about a number of things. Perhaps grants would be one of them, but also to make sure that we understand their position on when they would require, if ever, a customer to connect to this system. Now, they so far have refused to answer that question. So there's an easy way and a hard way to get that answer, and I'm hoping we can get it the easy way by meeting. Determine the process needed to create a special district. Possibly do a survey of all the owners and give them the choices that exist, which are an aggressive inspection program, a surcharge, or a district with a tax. We could lay that out and ask all those people around the lake to give us their take on that. And then we need to find out, we have a preliminary take that the system would not, which is an anaerobic, meaning without oxygen, system, that the digestion of the waste occurs without oxygen, with a bacteria that is functions without oxygen, and it's placing that septic material into an aerobic digester, which is our sewer plant. We don't think that that would cause a problem, but we need to get a little bit more science on that to make sure. And then finally, there's some legalities to all this that I would need to be checked out. Can we impose a surcharge of this magnitude on all these customers? Again, how would a district be formed? What's the likelihood that it would be formed? I believe the county commissioners, for example, could call an election on this and put it out to the voters and let them decide. So, but anyway, that could all be summarized. So the question for council is, do you want to move forward on this? And if so, give us some direction.
Well, this was definitely good news.
I thought so.
As in a reminding council and the public, you know, it was $30 million plus that has been talked about.
In the 80s, I believe.
In the past, yeah. Down to five. I guess the other thing I was just wondering about is your number five point, but the capacity of the system, of the sewer plant, is not an issue, correct? This is different. This question is mixing in the type of sewage or what has happened to it. Is what number five?
Yeah,
is not a capacity issue.
Yeah, well, I mean, capacity of the plant is dependent on a couple of things. One, it's dependent on the amount of growth. It's not designed to handle an unlimited amount of growth. There is a limit to it. And there's two limitations to the plant. One is the amount of the hydraulic limitation, which is the amount of volume, which in our case is winter stormwater. That's one limitation. The other limitation, which comes in our peak season, which is the amount of biodegradable material. Two different capacity issues. Either one can be limiting. This, because it's a pressure system, would not be susceptible to infiltration. So it would not interject any stormwater into the system. It interjects purely biodegradable material and household water.
Yeah.
Okay. So, but no infiltration. So it's the mix of how much growth of what types and how well can we handle the infiltration issue, because this is not going to affect the winter treatment. this would affect the summer. Depends how much growth we get.
Great. Other comments?
It certainly should handle the expected life of the sewer plant 20 to 30 years.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Ryan.
I believe several years ago we received a survey from Paddle that they had taken of most of the residents around the east side of the lake, that they thought sewering was a good idea and were all in favor of it and were willing to be participants.
Well,
seems to me that was about 6 to 8 years ago.
Oh, I think it must have been a lot longer ago than that, but I'm not sure.
Well, I was on council before, so I know it was during that time period.
Okay. Well, I think it was a very fragmented returns. I think it was not a lot of returns on that.
I was just kind of curious because that seemed to me to indicate that there was had been or was interest in sewering.
Yeah, but you know, there's a lot of different ways of asking that question. Are you in favor of sewer? Yes. Are you willing to pay for it? No. I mean, that's kind of how...
Well, but the figures that we were tossing around, had been tossing around, had been like $25-30 million.
Right.
I think $4 million is something that's, certainly it's a big number, but it's certainly much more doable. The they struck me as I'm reading this is, why don't we just end? Because if we have the 5-year or 7-year plan to sewer it, that's one of the things that you have to have when you want to annex something. It makes sense.
Well,
I know you don't, but I heard the collective sigh from gasp from
yeah.
The staff. But I'm just, you know, there you go. I mean, that's one of the reasons why like Niatsu, you know, you really even think about trying to annex Niatsu because we didn't have a plan for the sewering, and you have to have a plan if you're going to sewer it or to sewer it in order to annex it. You got to come up with a plan. You got to have a cost analysis. Well, we got one. Now we could. Now we could theoretically.
Well, but annexing
the whole thing.
Annexing doesn't change the financial equation.
Well, no, it doesn't, but it gives us, then it's our taxing district.
No, then it's the whole city.
Well, okay.
I don't know the likelihood of asking the city voters as a whole to pay for sewering around the lake.
It was a thought that
occurred. No, the more alternatives that can be explored at this point, the better.
But I would be interested in what kind of a taxing district that we can come up. I was surprised that Delwood, or Devil's Lake Water Improvement District, could not do this kind of
thing. Well, I don't know if that's the definitive answer. That's just what the information I'm getting so far, mostly from Devil's Lake Water Improvement District.
Right.
Okay.
Councilor Ellingson, you?
Yeah, I get nervous. No offense, Wes.
That's okay.
I hope we're still friends. I don't want annexation to be any part of this subject, quite frankly. I just want to make it crystal clear to people. And I have said it, and this is the first time that I've heard a council person say it, and I'm glad he said it in public, because I can honestly tell you I have had no one say it to me in private, nor have I been in any meeting where it has been brought up. Annexing, there are several other factors that all have to come into play in order for it to make sense. And quite frankly, there's a lot of areas around the lake that we wouldn't want to annex. It's just real simple. But
how are you with the sewering?
I'm very hopeful and that unlike 30 years ago when we thought something was imminent, that this really can be the answer. You know, it seems like technology, where oftentimes as time goes on and costs multiply and get added and sometimes it just goes completely out of reach. Technology can sometimes, not very often, but sometimes provide something that you need to take a hold of that actually works. And I think hopefully this would be one of those instances. I know David spoke to, you know, checking the plant operation once the effluent gets down there, but I would like to simultaneously along with that, and he alludes to this in some of his other thinking, our delivery system. You said introducing that type of product into parts of our delivery system may present things that we have to deal with. So I'd like to be have as many of those things thought through and thought out as we go through the discussion with people. I think, you know, if somebody was asking me at first blush, I think we would be wise to look into the possibility of a district just for the grant. David had mentioned, and it's amazing, him doing this on the back of a napkin, and he keeps saying, "Is the back of my napkin," but his figures are actually...
That was just luck.
Well, what actually is happening, and so, you know, a sizable grant would lessen the initiation or the buy-in cost by maybe 50%.
If I can, David, could we make sure that the city really is precluded from, I guess, knowing who our partners are, and we've gotten strong commitments.
I agree.
And if the only reason we need a district is try to go fishing for grants.
Well, it's not the only reason.
Okay.
It shifts the burden from a user charge, monthly user charge, to a property tax, which has some advantages.
Right.
And it can be, and first of all, for a lot of people, it can be tax deductible.
Right. Good point.
It guarantees a lower bond rate because it's a general obligation bond as opposed to a revenue bond, and that there are some major advantages to that. So it's not
good.
Just
good.
Grant.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I agree, and the first place I think to be looking is DEQ. DEQ has not advanced any regulations to deal with this problem. Help us out, guys. What can you do for us? What can you help us? Here's a city that's talking about 2/3 of the customers that are outside the city. We're trying to find a solution for everybody. Help us out here. See what we can get from that. Maybe we just get a blank stare.
Councillor, I guess I'm trying to sense from you a willingness to advance.
I'd like to advance. I mean, if you're asking me of a district versus, you know, a surcharge, I guess as much as I want sewering personally, I'm not trying to speak for anyone other than myself, around the lake, I'd say, yeah, let's surcharge, let's just get this done. Probably have the most direct control over a surcharge. We could do that the quickest, and it'd be the easiest, but it might not be the most financially advantageous.
Okay.
And so, I'd like to think about that. And I already mentioned the last meeting. I thank you for your leadership relative to the revitalization discussion, the septic tank revitalization discussion, because I think that still has a place in this bigger picture of what we're now talking about, insofar as if people are voting for a district or even voting by virtue of not trying to recall us or something for taking action relative to surcharge, they have to know the consequences, the pluses and the minuses. the plus of voting for a district is that with the infiltration that's going on around the lake right now, we're going to have to deal with it by revitalizing or and the sewering is going to be infinitely less expensive. Therefore, if I'm voting, I vote for...
No, I agree with how it gets positioned. Yeah.
That's about everything that's on my mind right at the moment.
Councilman Rikus?
I would support staff moving ahead with exploring this further, which means meeting with Dilwid and meeting with DEQ and determining whether our plant can handle this new effluent. But I would also point out that in a very thoughtful email from Brian Green, he points out that formation of a sanitary district as a funding mechanism would, he believes, require two ballot measures and two separate votes as a matter of Oregon Constitution law, and I believe he's right. And that complicates things for me in terms of forming the district. But if we can somehow form a district without putting it off for years, then I would certainly support that. I think it would be very difficult for people to swallow a 40% surcharge on their water bill every month, but we're not there yet.
$40, not 40%. But
$40, yes.
Yeah. Mr. Mayor, I know I already had my say, but is it all right if I say one more thing?
Yeah.
On a completely unrelated matter, because I didn't know much about ballot initiatives or ballot measures, it isn't really that difficult to get something on a ballot, at least not here in this area. It requires a few hundred signatures, not a few thousand. And so somebody that has an interest in something, it takes a little bit of time, and you have to go through the process, but...
Well, I think what I heard Councilman Rikus say, you know, he doesn't want, if it's going to be 2 or 3 years,
right?
You know, so
I mean,
more
exploration. It would take somebody getting behind it and doing it, but you could get it done pretty quickly.
Well, it's certainly one of the items to.
You could get something on a ballot pretty quickly.
Gentlemen, thoughts?
I think we explored the direction we can go yet. So, I mean, to me, we have.
Yeah. Okay.
Problems that we have, sewers that we have. Like what Gary was saying.
Okay.
So, I mean, it has to happen, really.
You're certainly willing to advance it until we know more. Still in the
Absolutely.
Gathering.
Okay. And move forward and let's just explore options.
Okay. I think this council is definitely interested and sees the importance of it. And, you know, until we have information that would block us. And I say this as an onerous inspection, septic inspection as well, both much that we've talked previously about is bringing an inspection ordinance or resolution or whatever it takes of septic tanks absent the date of when it goes into play. But so when we're advancing things, you know, both need to advance in case the sewering gets sidetracked.
Agreed.
Okay.
I don't want to use the word onerous.
Because it's going to be anyway.
I think what you probably mean is the comprehensive inspection requirement.
Yes, I do. But, yeah, that's kind of where we, council had left it, was trying to decide what type of inspection. So, what else?
That's it. We'll advance this and keep you informed as we go, and I'll put it on an agenda every time we have something of significance to report. It's not going to be overnight. But I don't. Right now, I don't see a fatal flaw. Financing, of course, is always going to be the tough one. And it's not like the city can run out and form a district. We can't. It would take initiation of some people. that aren't the city to do that. Anyway, yeah, we'll advance all these questions and a few more.
Mr. Tucker, before I leave, I have on my calendar a hold date for the 17th of September, where we originally talked about a work session on the villages, and then we had come up with the one in August.
Right.
Are we holding the 17th date? Okay. So,
sorry.
No,
we just moved that up.
That's right.
I'm not going to get into all the reasons why we did that, but it worked out good. And
okay.
So,
Counselor, if you had the 17th on your calendar, you can remove that.
Remove it, Your Honor?
Remove it, yeah. City Attorney. Oh, excuse me, hold on.
I have one question.
Sure.
For the City Manager, if I may. Mr. Hawker, have you had a chance to make a decision on that mushball tournament?
No, I haven't.
Any feedback from?
I don't believe I got any public feedback. And all the feedback that I had from staff was in advance of what I had already said. So maybe that's why I didn't trigger anything happening, is because I was hoping to hear some feedback from people out there. And I don't recall that I received any. Certainly not more than maybe one email. Right now, if I had to make a decision right now, I would lean towards placing some conditions on it, and that may require some enabling legislation to be able to do that. I don't like to just say, well, there's some problems here, let's just cancel. Let's deal with the problems. And if there's effective ways of dealing with the problems, and I think that there are, the police chief has made a recommendation to me on how to deal with that. The Parks Department has made a recommendation on how to deal with that. So I'm kind of going to look at those and say, you know, maybe that's what we ought to do. Do I have the authority to impose those? I don't know.
Okay.
The police chief had suggested that they fund an officer to during the entire tournament, and Parks has suggested what the cost of cleanup is, and requested a deposit to cover that. So, yes, I'm sorry. I did get one email from a neighbor of a VRD from a party that occurred in a vacation rental dwelling that was over the top from what this neighbor had said. And I referred that to both PD and to Planning Department to check it out and see what it was all about and what action can be taken, et cetera. So it sounded like it was over the top.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
You know, I got feedback, and I wasn't going to bring it up now, but what David, as he just analyzed the situation and what he said he is going to do about it, I think would take care of the concern that I have heard. And that would be that we don't just summarily do away with something without making sure that there aren't options available to see if it can work out. And so,
well, that's what I'm leaning towards right now. So let's give it, I'll announce something at the next meeting and give it between now and then for people to weigh in on this.
Maybe you can hear from the guy I heard from.
Okay. All right. City Attorney.
I actually do have an item. We had a request from the U.S. Department of Justice for a memorandum of agreement or understanding with the police department. It's just simply one of those federal reimbursement for our officer overtime MOU. It's a temporary in nature. So because it came in on short notice and it's basically a temporary agreement, I'd ask your permission to let the chief of police sign the agreement.
And does that take a motion?
I'd ask for either unanimous consent or a motion.
How about a motion that would allow the chief of police to sign this MOU?
So moved.
We have such a motion, and voice vote is, or do you, all those in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed, with a nay. Hearing none. Thank you. Otherwise, you're all right.
Yes.
Okay.
I think the next item is actually calling for public comments.
It is. We're on public comments, and we have a first reading of a proposed ordinance.
Actually, item H on the agenda is just the first asking for comments.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. Thank you. This would be then I would open the for anyone in the audience that has a public comment regarding proposed ordinance 2013-12 for a social gambling permit. And seeing none, hearing none.
Mr. Mayor, yep. Is that 2013-0909 or 2? Where am I? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
Yep.
So we're talking about the social gambling.
Correct. Or asking the public for any comments regarding the next ordinance.
Because the ordinance sets an application fee, it requires that whenever you set a fee under 294-160, you ask for public comment.
So hearing none, seeing none, let's move on then to the first reading of ordinance number 2013-12.
Okay, this is the first reading of an ordinance amending the Lincoln City Municipal Code, Title 9, Public Peace, Morals, and Welfare, Chapter 9.24, Social Gambling, relating to clarification of definitions, background check processing, and appeal procedures, establishing an application fee for a social games permit, and correcting penalties for noncompliance. This item was essentially brought forward because the state police contacted the city recorder about our enforcement and ordinances on gambling. And as you can see from the council communication, there's one mistake in the communication. We're going to leave the record open, if you decide to do this, to the 18th and continue the ordinance for second reading on the 23rd. And I think there's one mistaken date in the council communication. But the simply put, the ordinance corrects an error in the existing code. The fine is something like $250,000 in our code, which is not legal. It also establishes an application fee, which my understanding is there is no application fee currently. It does refer appeals to the Uniform Administrative Appeals Ordinance, which you adopted earlier this year. It doesn't do anything with relation to bingo, lotto, raffles, except add Monte Carlo events to that list. Apparently, your ordinance is probably established before Monte Carlo events was added to this statute. So we're simply catching it up. So you're basically, you have the ability to prohibit bingo and those kind of things in the city. You've chosen not to prohibit them, but basically say they're authorized as long as they're consistent with state licensure and regulations. The only thing you're doing with social games is essentially reaffirming that a permit is required. And clarifying that the penalty for not having a city permit is a Class A violation. And otherwise, you're saying, you know, the criminal statutes that are out there under state law are there for be advised, but we're not trying to create a penalty that's the equivalent of a criminal penalty. That's essentially it. It's not the most exciting ordinance, but it does establish a base fee and then require that the fee be can be modified by resolution.
I guess a question I have, and I'm assuming there's more detail on bingo, lotto, and raffles.
It is regulated by a state license, and you have to go through a process and be in compliance with those regulations. But because you're doing nothing other than, say, comply with state law, I didn't get into all that detail.
So when I guess my question is, so the next time you do a 50-50 raffle or something, we should be checking and inspect, you know, a permit?
We don't issue a permit for bingo or lotto or raffles. All we do is require that you talk to the state and get, and it's my understanding it's something like you demonstrate you're actually 501c3 or what, and you have a tax exempt status, and you do that and you get your permit. I don't know all the details because I've never done it, but we're just telling you we're not regulating it. The state's
we're not bringing a burden onto the city with this, other than saying if you're going to do it, get with the state. And
yes, okay. The police chief did ask, and I forgot to mention, so I'm going to read it. He did ask that I add a mental state into one of the where I list what the offenses are. And if you're participating in an unlicensed event, essentially you should be doing so knowingly in order to get a penalty. So if you're participating in an event and you know that you're participating in an event that is unlicensed, then you'd be subject to a penalty. So adding the word knowingly is the only word we would add, and let me just tell you where that is. And this would be under B on page 5 of the ordinance. I'm sorry, C, knowingly participating in a social game that is operating without the required permit. I'm sorry, wrong. It's also D. I think it's just C.
Okay.
But we're adding the word knowingly. And I'll correct it for the second
read. Any other questions, counsel, regarding this ordinance?
Huh? You have to read it a couple of times to get it.
Yeah. Entertain a motion then.
Move to. Well, first reading.
And set the second reading of the ordinance for September 23rd, 2013. Authorize receipt of written comments into the record until September 18th, 2013 at noon.
Okay. All of that.
Second.
We have a motion with a second. Roll call, please.
Quant.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Ryan. Eggleton.
Yes.
Ellingson.
Yes.
And Norikis.
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you. And we have a ordinance for a second reading, ordinance number 2013-13.
This is the second reading of the moving building ordinance. So this is second reading of an ordinance amending the Lincoln City Municipal Code, Title 15, Buildings and Construction, Chapter 15.12, Moving Buildings, relating to clarification of exemptions and updating processing fees, performance bond coverage, and penalties. The only change that occurred since the last first reading, was that we recommend you add a whereas clause that would read, whereas consistent with ORS Chapter 294-160, the public was provided with an opportunity to comment on the proposed fee changes in the proposed ordinance. And also, planning staff asked that I address applications in process, so we add a new Section 6 and 7 and renumber. 6 would then read, applications, this amendment, the amendments to this chapter shall not apply to applications deemed complete for processing by the Community Development Department prior to the effective date of this ordinance, provided that such applications are timely processed to completion and a permit issued within 180 days from the date the application was first deemed complete. And then Section 7, Savings Clause, would be, notwithstanding the amendment to this chapter, the existing chapter remains valid and in full force and effect for purposes of all code enforcement cases filed or commenced during the time said ordinances were operative. Nothing in Ordinance 2013-13 affects the validity of prosecutions commenced and continued under the laws in effect at the time the matters were originally filed. And so those two sections are essentially kind of boilerplate sections, but the first one, the application, was intended to address, as I told you, there was an application that had been submitted, which kind of triggered all this, and staff believes that it's been enough time that's probably deemed withdrawn at this point, but we wanted to cover them just in case. The savings clause was just in case we did decide if we find somebody that violated the ordinance in effect that it wouldn't want to interfere with the prosecution. So those with if those changes are accepted, we'd ask that you approve the ordinance for adoption, approve second reading and adoption of the ordinance with the changes as read.
Okay. I would so move.
Second.
We have a motion with a second to approve.
Norakis?
Yes.
Quant?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Ryan?
Yes.
Eggleton? And Ellingson?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you very much. This will be the time again for citizen comments.
Gene Scruton, A1 Beach Rentals and Whistling Winds Motel. I was just going to comment on some of the VCB stuff there. I think Sandy gave a pretty good report. But it seems like there's, I don't want to be negative here, but I'm just throwing this out. It seems like there's a disconnect when I talk to other motel vacation rental owners and the VCB and why that is. I don't know if they think the money's spent wrong or what. And I've said it numerous times before, but it's never done it. It wouldn't be that hard to send out a questionnaire with the transroom tax packet they send in, the rating, how they think they're doing, other thoughts of ideas to bring in money. I mean, a lot of people aren't sold on these events. You know, if you got a marquee event like Newport where you bring in just guy, you know, for the Crab Festival, that's one thing. But these small ones like the Pride Festivals this weekend, and I'm not getting on the Pride Festival, but we're one of three motels, I think, on a website, was on their website deal there. And I think we were about 30% full, and I think some of those were comp rooms, and I think, and I don't know how many were at the festival. So, you know, I don't know if we've ever got the information if I know Sandy says traditional advertising is dead, but I see the casinos advertising. I see Newport.org on the billboards coming down here, so I'm not totally sold on that. That's why I think it'd be important to have that survey because, you know, the boots on the ground, the people, I'm sure Gary and Wes get an idea why people come down, and I've said it before. Also, it wouldn't be very expensive to do surveys of customers why they come down. Like I said, you can get all the numbers you want from them, but it doesn't tell you why people are down here. And I think I've said it before. We did a survey 1 month at the motel, and we didn't find many people at all using coming down for services that the city had or special events. So I think those numbers could be brought together fairly cheap, you know, and I think it'd be really good numbers to have. And like my wife was saying, you know, people go to Hawaii and Sun River and Black Butte. There's no events going on there. They go there for the natural resources, which the beach has. You don't go to the beach saying, I'm going down to the beach to get a suntan. People come to the beach for a reason, not that it doesn't have to be things to do. I'm still not sold that more advertising needs to be done any off months, just to get people to go look at the website to come to Lincoln City. And maybe some of that money from those events, if they're not really paying off, could be used for that. It's like, you know, like having a car event, it's great, but in Portland, which is a large amount of people come from, there's a run out called Beaches every Wednesday. There's 1,500 cars with a live band and food and everything every Wednesday. So to get people to drive down here for just that reason, for a car show, I'm not sure about. But I think it would be really good to get some more information, because, like I say, I feel a frustration among other, especially as it gets slow, you know, what the money's being spent on. And I think with the input from the owners and input from some customers, I think we could get a better idea why really people are coming down here. So anyway, just a thought. Thank you.
Gene, do you mind sharing with us, not dollars or anything like that, but this year, your year-to-date compared to last year, are you up?
Well, in our vacation rental business, we had to take on a couple other houses because we anticipated it being down, and it seemed like after the election in November, everything just went psh, and then it kind of leveled out early spring. But we've raised our prices at our motel, try to make it nicer and try to get a little better clientele. Not that we had a bad clientele, but to try to get a little better. So I think the money's fairly close, but less customers. In the vacation rental, we had about the same amount, but we took on two extra homes in anticipation. But I have a feeling it's going to be kind of a long winter for a lot of people. I've heard rumors of a couple businesses that are going down or closing and so forth. So I think it's going to be a really long winter. And I think the frustration with a lot of the people in the tourism business is it's not being directed the right way. And maybe it is. It would be a good way to put those people, you know, the rest there. But it'd be neat to see. I mean, say you had 1,000 people reply to them, and only 3% of them were coming for special events or city-sponsored deal, then you might take another look at that. If it was a high percentage, then everybody will be quiet and we'll keep on. So,
good. Thank you. Any other comments? Hearing none. Mr. Ryan, what?
Actually, I wanted to follow up on what he just said, because it just occurred to me that if we had some sort of a city survey, a printed brochure, whether it's you know, just a simple fold four-page thing that had some questions on it, I think most of the motels would hand these to guests and have them leave them in the rooms, or they could mail them back to the city, or bring them back to the front desk. I think we could get a better participation from the, I think the motels would do that, and it would be a nice way to get a survey for the city. It would, the printing costs would be a little expensive, but I think it might be a very helpful tool. I think that's okay. A good idea. I don't know why we didn't think. We have our own survey, but, you know, that's just for us. But one for the city would be very good.
Okay.
I got a bug over here.
Councilor Hunson, what's up?
I don't really have anything. Okay. You know, I relative to what Wes is saying and Gina is saying, and I think it is a good idea. I have been acutely aware of for years, really, and more so recently, of the fact that motel owners or lodging owners or the hospitality industry doesn't have an association. I wish sometimes that the city wouldn't have to do these types of things for us. We should be doing it for ourselves and then offer it, you know, to the city and see if it would be of any benefit. But because we don't, I guess we have to ask for somebody else to do it for us, at least for the time being. And sometime we used to have an association, and it was, on top of being productive, it was a lot of fun, but we just haven't had one for years and years. So
okay. Councilor Norakis?
Nothing, thank you.
Gordy, what have you?
Mr. Sutton out there also, that I think a survey would be good. One reason I see it is there's a house across the street from me that holds a large capacity of people. And when I speak with those people, they come down here mainly because of their family event that everybody gets together down here. And I don't see any events attracting across the street from me to that place. I also say, I sure wish we could get these 34-page reports earlier to read and study. That's all I have to say.
Thank you. Henry?
I just noticed a couple new bus stops popping up through town.
Shelters?
North End. Shelters, yeah. There's one over there on right by Safeway on on Logan Road, and there's another one popped up by the casino. I don't know if that's the city or casino putting them up. I mean, I came up to the shopping center today, and there's a bus stop over there, and there's the county buses stopped there, and it's taking on passengers. I think it was. I don't know.
I was not aware that we were putting up any additional shelters. We're moving the one by the Freed Gallery, moving it. So if it's happening, it's happening without me knowing, although things do happen here without me knowing.
I was just going to make a comment. All of a sudden, these bus stops started appearing. I didn't hear anything from anybody. Just kind of...
Well, I'm curious now, so yeah, I'm going to find out.
Ask Public Works, huh?
See what they're up to.
Mr. Mayor,
yep.
I don't think this necessarily has to do with this piece of information, but later this year, there's going to be a public transportation to Grand Ronde.
When you get specifics, be sure to share it, because that's been...
it's going to be in the last quarter.
Right.
We're getting near...
We're getting
near that,
getting
so
close.
We'll try to get you an exact.
Yeah, the idea is to get public transportation through to Salem, because that's still a gap there. So that
Salem or McMinnville,
yeah.
Or
yeah.
Wherever you want to go after you get to Grand Ronde.
Let's see. Two things. One's a thank you, Mr. Hawker. If you'd make sure staff is thanked, again reflecting on the last week's tour that we took of Agnes Creek. Open space and the demonstration thinning project, and right on schedule. I noticed it's on the Lincoln City website as information, so the public really ought to click on it, take a look. There's a new trail, there's a map right there, so all you need. But what this has done for me is made a new walking area, nice path, easy grade, relatively easy grade through one of our open spaces. So
We are graveling the trailhead there, probably about $1,500, and we will put up a sign. I'm not sure we'll get to an interpretive sign right away, but we certainly can get something that redirects people to our website, because I thought that was fairly explanatory, that couple of pages that are put on there about why it was done and what it's to achieve.
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting if you read that and go out and actually look.
Well, and I was surprised at the amount of growth already, underground growth that had popped up since been done, which promising.
It'll be interesting to watch that over a few years.
I agree. The other thing is just information for those who are so inclined. There's tomorrow night, Tuesday, 7 p.m., the school district, the board meeting, school board meeting, meets at Ocean Lake Elementary. I'll be there because I think it's important that when the school board actually comes to Lincoln City that they get certainly elected officials there. And then, again, reminding the public of the upcoming Celebration of Honor sponsored by Chinook Winds. Starts the 19th, goes through the weekend, a lot of activities. And with that, any other information?
Yes. I do have a question. Mr. Hawker can answer it. When will that Harbor Street concept be available where we'll have an idea of what's going on that?
I don't have a date. We'll be coming to you before too long. I'm relatively sure of that.
Thank you.
I don't have an exact date. There may be one, and I just don't know what it is.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
We'll be watching for it. And all right, let's stand adjourned. Thank you.
7 p.m.
7 p.m.